I'm so happy to see you. And I think you know what I mean when I talk about happiness. But what is the source of this happiness? What is the root of happiness? It's an important question to ask. So I want to share with you three stories, each one capturing a different way of understanding where happiness comes from. Story number one. This guy goes to a therapist, and the therapist says, "Today we're going to talk about Freudian slips." Freudian slips are those funny mistakes we make sometimes when we want to say one thing, but we end up saying something completely different. Did you have any of these funny mistakes, Freudian slips, recently? So the guy thinks for a minute and then says, "Oh, actually, I made a Freudian slip, one of those funny mistakes, last night. I was having dinner with my parents, and I wanted them to pass me the salad. But instead I said, 'You stupid idiots, I hate you, you ruined my life.'" According to this story, happiness is a result of circumstances, of upbringing, of nurture. It's what we experienced before that determines what we are today. Let's go to story number two. A man and a woman go out on a date, first date, after they just met on the internet. They go to a movie, the commercials begin, and not a minute passes when the guy makes his move, sending his arm toward the woman. The woman, noticing this, slaps his hand away, and the guy, taken aback, says, "You know, I can't help my behavior, it's in my genes." To which the woman responds, "I don't care what's in your genes, just stay out of mine." This is about the source of happiness being in our genes. It's about nature. That's what matters. Story number three. This one is taken from Dan Millman's wonderful book, The Path of the Peaceful Warrior. Millman talks about Sam. Sam is a constructions worker. Every day, Sam goes to work on a building site. And every day, at noon, Sam and his co-workers break for lunch. Every day, Sam takes out his lunchbox, looks at it, and says, "Oh no, not peanut butter and jelly sandwich again." This goes on for months and months until finally one of his co-workers, another construction site worker, says to Sam, "Sam, enough complaining already. Just tell your wife to make you another sandwich." To which Sam responds, "My wife? I'm not married. I make my own sandwiches." This is about happiness dependent on our choices. And we all want to believe that happiness is indeed dependent on our choices. It's an empowering story. But is it true? Is happiness actually about our genes? Is it about our circumstances? Or is it about our choices? Because if it is only about our circumstances, well, then we need to just focus on education and parenting. If it is just about our genes, well, then we need to focus on medication, on biology and chemistry. And if it is about our choices, then we need to think about those in a deeper, more meaningful way. What is the answer? Well, there's been a lot of research over the years searching for the answer. One of the most important studies has become known as the Minnesota Twin Studies. This experiment was conducted on identical twins, monozygotic twins, who were reared apart. So the exact same genetic makeup, but these twins were raised in different countries, often different continents. So for example, one twin was raised in Europe, while the other one, with the same genes, in Africa. One was in the United States, the other one was in China. The question that they asked was, how much of who or what we are is determined by our genetic makeup, and how much is determined by our circumstances? And then the third question, is there anything left over for choices, for our own decisions, for our volition, for our free will? Because we know people who just seem to have been born cheerful. They're happy all the time, no matter what happens to them. On the other hand, there are people where very good things happen to them, and yet they are unhappy, not cheerful, sad, anxious. Is it all about genes? This is what the Minnesota twin study attempted to answer. Is it nature or nurture? Is it our biology or the environment? Is it the genes or the upbringing? There's a lot of research on leadership that asks a similar question. It asks, are leaders born or made? Or do they make themselves? The exact same thing we can ask about happiness. Are happy people born? Are happy people made? Or do they make themselves? So let's look at some examples from the Minnesota twin studies. Remember, these are twins reared apart, the exact same genetic makeup, who met when they were around 40 years old. So let's take one set of twins. They didn't know about the existence of the other. Both coincidentally were named James. Both coincidentally ended up marrying a Linda. Neither of them were very happy with Linda. So both of them, not knowing about the existence of the other, both of them married a Betty. Betty was a lot better. They also had a lovely dog, whom they both named Toy. Now, this seems mystical, so let's leave the mystical aside and look at some of the psychological similarities. Both took law enforcement classes. They were interested in that. Both learned technical drawing and carpentry. They had good hands. And when it came to psychological measures, basically identical. Whether it was on sociability, whether it was on self-control, whether it was on cognitive flexibility. Basically identical. Reared apart, not even knowing about the existence of the other. Let's take another example. These two twins, though they looked identical, didn't have the same names. They were Daphne and Barbara. Daphne and Barbara met for the first time at the age of 39. When they met, both of them came, coincidence perhaps, both of them came to the meeting wearing a brown dress and a beige velvet jacket. Both of them had the habit of pushing their nose up every once in a while. And both of them were compulsive gigglers. In their social network, the most cheerful, the happiest of all. On other psychological measures, basically identical. There was story after story after story of twins reared apart, different cultures, different schools, different families, and yet displaying remarkable, sometimes mystical, similarities. This research that was conducted by serious psychologists and sociologists from around the world led some of them to make claims like this. It may be that trying to be happier is as futile as trying to be taller and is therefore counterproductive. In other words, it's all about your genes. The stamp that you get when you get out into this world, it stays with you for the rest of your life. This line, as it is, was taken and brought to popular media. The New York Times wrote about this, about how genes determine everything, essentially. That we can't really change our levels of happiness, and if we try to do that, well, it's a waste of your time. You'll just be more frustrated, that's all. Just like you would be frustrated if you try to change your height. There were different reactions when this study came out, and again, made a huge splash in popular media as well. Huge reactions to it. Basically can be divided into two camps. The first camp, the first reaction was a sense of relief. Because, you know, this came out in 1996, and in the 80s, 90s, certainly today, the self-help movement is thriving. And much of the message from the self-help movement or the New Age movement is, you can do anything. Everything is up to you. If you want to make a difference in your life, if you want to be happy, well, it's just up to you, which also means if I'm not happy, it's my fault. So there were many people who have read these books, who got excited by these books, who would say to themselves, you know, I'm not happy and it's my fault. So not only were they unhappy, they were made to feel even worse by blaming themselves, by feeling useless, unable to make a difference, a positive difference in their life. So for these people, it was a relief. okay, so it's not my fault. And they would say something like, I no longer have to engage in this futile battle to become happier, nor do I need to feel guilty about doing nothing. I can finally just chill, relax, accept my lot. Preferably with a margarita. Accepting this, that this is my lot, means that what is left, if we want to change our levels of well-being, is to change our chemistry, our biology, through medication, perhaps. It's all about our genes, after all. There was another reaction, beyond relief, and that is resignation. Being hopeless and helpless. Because if I'm not happy now, what can I do? There's nothing I can do. I may have been unhappy for the last 10 years, but at least I had some hope. I thought I could make a difference. But now I can't. I feel helpless, hopeless. And it led many people to say something like, that's it? And there is nothing I can do to become happier? I need a margarita. Which one is true, though? Which one is correct? Are people as happy as their genes determine? Or are people as happy as their circumstances allow them to be? Is it the environment? Or are people as happy as they make up their minds to be? It's a big question. It's a very important question to ask. Because the answer to this question makes a big difference. Now, usually the big questions, such as the question of nature or nurture or choices, these big questions usually don't have answers, don't have clear answers. They've been debated for thousands of years without a resolution. Well, this particular question does have an answer. And here is the answer. The answer is that genes do matter. The psychologists were right, as is evident by the Minnesota twin studies. At the same time, so does our environment. Our environment matters a great deal, as evident by cultural differences, by schools, by parenting. These things do matter. And very clearly, it turns out, our choices matter as well. But how do we know that? How do we know that choices matter as well? Well, first of all, there is counter evidence to the Minnesota twin studies. Counter evidence showing that people do change. For example, we know that therapy helps. People who go to therapy and different kinds of therapy, after a while they begin to change. We also know that people who read certain books and suddenly have this aha moment, this insight, actually do change. They decide to make a big difference in their life, and they do. We also know that from personal experiences that something happened to us and then we made a resolution to bring about change in our lives, and we did it. Wasn't easy, perhaps didn't happen overnight, but it happened. There are counterexamples. You see, what the Minnesota twin studies did, the error they made was the error of the average. The error of the average is about looking at the mean, at the average, and extrapolating, generalizing from it to the whole. But it's only the average. And the average, there are outliers. There are counterexamples. For instance, even among those twins, yes, there were remarkable similarities, but there were also twins, identical monozygotic twins, who led radically different lives. Whether it was because of their external circumstances or because of decisions that they made, because of the choices that they made. In other words, there were exceptions. The error of the average reminds me of a story of two statisticians who didn't know how to swim. And they went to the pool and they drowned in the pool with an average depth of 50 centimeters. You see, the average cannot tell us about the capacity, the depth of a pool, or the capacity, the ability of human beings. It's not a universal truth. It's a trend. It's an average. That's all there is. And when there are exceptions, they potentially prove the rule. The question is no longer when there is an exception. The question is no longer whether or not it's possible to change. The question becomes, how is it possible to change? Because if one person does it, so can another and another. The problem with the research, the Minnesota Twin Studies, or rather the problem with the conclusions of that research, is that it hurts, that it's detrimental. Imagine a 12-year-old girl reading the New York Times. She's personally unhappy, sad. Reading there that trying to change her happiness levels is as futile as trying to change her height. What will she experience as a result? Hopelessness, sadness, even depression. You know, the difference between sadness and depression is not in the experience. With sadness, we see an end to it. There is hope. Depression is sadness minus the hope. And this is what this kind of research leads to. Hopelessness, helplessness, and potentially depression, where it's not necessary. David Lycan, who's one of the researchers in the Minnesota Twin Studies, was interviewed in 2005 for Time magazine, where he said, "I made a dumb statement in the original article. It's clear that we can change our happiness levels widely, up or down. The question is, how much? How much is determined by our genes? How much is determined by our circumstances? And how much is left over for our choices? Is it a lot? Is it a little? And aren't our choices also determined by how we were raised, where we were raised, and by our genetic makeup?" And the answer is yes, absolutely. But what psychologists did over the years with serious, rigorous research and analysis was they tried to pull apart, to tease out the impact of each of these three components. And here is the conclusion that they came to. I want to share with you research done by Sonia Lubomirsky and Ken Sheldon, as well as others who contributed, who show that the pie of happiness is divided in the following way. About 50%, about half of our levels of happiness is determined by our genes. Now, this is average. There are people for whom genes affect much more than 50%. People with certain dispositions, maybe a very negative disposition, and it affects their happiness levels or their unhappiness by much more than 50%, or people with very cheerful dispositions for whom genes matter more than 50%, but on average, 50%. Then 10% of the source of happiness resides with external circumstances, environment, where we were raised, how much money we have, the weather. Now, this is on average. There are, of course, external circumstances that impact our levels of well-being by much more than 10%. I mean, think, for example, people who live in dire poverty. Of course, their happiness levels are going to be impacted by more than 10%. Or people living in a war zone. Or women living in places where they're oppressed. But on average, if we have our basic needs met, basic needs in terms of material needs, basic needs in terms of safety and freedom, then on average, external circumstances matter only 10%. Not a lot. There are 40% remaining. These 40% are about our choices. Small choices and large choices. Choices that we make at different times in our lives. Choices that we make every minute in our lives. And I want to share with you some of these choices. What Happier TV is all about is highlighting, helping you become more mindful of these choices so that you can make better ones. Because you know, the 40% of choices, that's also average. And if you're mindful, if you're aware that you have these choices, you'll make much better choices and it will impact you by more than the 40% average. So here are examples of the choices that we make. Big choices are, what work do I pursue? We spend most of our waking hours at work. Do we choose work that is important for us, that is significant for us, that is meaningful? Or do we do something that is determined by extrinsic, external forces, what I think I should do, or what others think I should do? But it's not just the kind of work that we choose. It's also what we choose to focus on when we're at work. Because as a teacher, for example, I can choose to focus on the fact that I have to discipline all the time, or I can choose to primarily, not only, but primarily focus on the privilege that I have to cultivate the young minds and make a difference in the world. So what work do I choose matters a great deal. What I choose to focus in my work matters a great deal. Who do I share my life with? Another big choice. Who do I share my life with in terms of my partner, also in terms of my friends? Do I choose to share my life with the time, with friends, with people who are positive and uplifting? That has a huge impact on our levels of well-being, because emotions are contagious. Other choices, perhaps smaller choices. What do I do with my discretionary income? So if I have additional income, something that I don't need for my basic needs, because the basic needs matter a great deal. What do I do with my discretionary income? For example, do I choose to go on a vacation, or do I choose to upgrade my car? Do I choose experiences, or do I choose things? Most people think that buying things will make them happier because that thing will last for a long time. It turns out that actually buying experiences is a better choice, not just for short-term happiness, also for long-term happiness. So going on that family vacation, going for that meal with friends, ends up contributing more to our levels of happiness, being a better choice for us. Also, helping other people, donating money, volunteering, contributes a great deal to our well-being. In fact, much more so in the long term than going on a shopping spree that leads us to a shopper's high, but it doesn't last. Am I grateful? Am I thankful for what I have right now? Or do I take my life for granted? Because I may have all the wonderful, amazing, terrific things and take them for granted, and then I derive no happiness from them. Or I may have very little and derive a great deal of joy from the little that I have. Do I appreciate what I have? That to a great extent determines my overall levels of happiness. Here is a choice that we have with every encounter, whether at work, whether it's with the kids or with my partner. At every moment, with every encounter, we have a choice of what energy we bring. Do we bring negative energy or positive energy? Do we bring boredom or excitement? How do we respond to what our partner tells us when they come back home from work? That turns out to make a big difference in the quality of relationships. And that turns out to make a big difference in the quality of our days. Because one positive reaction to something that someone says leads to a positive reaction from them, and then it leads to an upward spiral. And it can literally color our entire day. And our life is made up of moments and days. How do I interpret failure? Do I see failure at work, on a test, on a date? Do I see failure as the end of the road, as a disaster, as a catastrophe, as something which is permanent and pervasive in my life? Or do I say to myself, well, this is just temporary. This is just specific. This too shall pass. Well, it turns out that this interpretation makes a big difference, not just to how well we live, but also to how long we live. People with a more positive interpretation style actually live longer. And this is something that we can learn. Yes, some people are born with a certain disposition to interpret failure or success in a particular way. And yet we can learn that style of interpretation, and that can make a big difference in the quality as well as the quantity of our life. Do I act with generosity and kindness? One of the best ways to raise levels of well-being is to contribute to others, to help others. You know, my favorite word in Hebrew is the word natan, which is to give. Natan is a palindrome. A palindrome is a number that you read in the same way from both sides. It's not a coincidence that this word is a palindrome, because to give is to receive. People who give are not just happier, they're also more resilient. They're stronger, their self-esteem is increased, not to mention the fact that they cultivate, that they create better relationships. Sonia Lubomirski has shown that people who introduce 5 additional acts of kindness a week significantly increase their overall levels of happiness. It doesn't have to be big things, it can be small things, but those small things can make a big difference. Those small changes, those small tweaks in the way we live our lives, those small choices lead to significant ramifications, consequences in our levels of happiness. And if we're mindful of the fact that we have a choice, that at every moment in your life you have a choice, that can impact your overall levels of happiness by more than 40%. And it's important to know that. It's important to recognize that choices make a difference, because recognizing that becoming happier is a choice is a first and critical step toward becoming happier. Because if we don't realize that we have a choice, then this recognition becomes a self-fulfilling prophecy. Just like that 12-year-old girl who is hopeless and helpless because she really believes that she can make no difference. It also becomes a self-fulfilling prophecy if I believe that I can make a difference in my life. In the words of Henry Ford, talking about success, but it applies as much to happiness, whether you think you can or can't, you are right. Choices make a difference. Now, having said that, so does luck. Whether it's your genetic pool luck, whether it's the luck that you have because you met someone or didn't meet someone. External circumstances, the environment, our parents make a big difference in our lives. And it's important to recognize this as well. Just as it's important to recognize that choices make a difference. So do our genes, so do our circumstances, so does luck. A lot of the self-help movement, a lot of the New Age movement makes the big mistake where they say it's all about your choice. You can make a difference in every area of your life. It's 100% up to you. That's simply not true. That's simply not true, and it leads to much unhappiness among millions and millions of people who devour these books and these messages. These people who live off on a false sense of hope, on an illusion. So do you know the book The Secret? Came out a few years ago, huge bestseller all over the world. So ever since The Secret came out, many people have come up to me and said, "Tal, so tell me, what is the secret to happiness?" And I say to them, "Come on. The secret to happiness? What do you take me for, some New Age self-help guy? I'm an academic. I'm serious. There's no secret to happiness. There are 3 secrets to happiness." And I'm going to tell you what these secrets are. I hope you're writing, because this is important. So here they are. The first secret to happiness. You ready? All right. The first secret to happiness is reality. The second secret to happiness is reality. Does anyone want to guess the third secret? You got it, reality. When Jack Welch, who was voted the CEO of the 20th century by Fortune magazine, when he was asked, "What tip do you have for managers, for leaders? What advice?" And he said, "I have one advice. Learn to face reality." It applies in leadership, it applies when it comes to happiness. Learn to face reality. And what does reality tell us? That genes do matter, that circumstance does matter, and the choices do matter. To capture this, I want to share with you a story that's very often told in introductory psychology texts. This is the story of a pair of twins, identical twins, monozygotic twins, just like in the Minnesota twin studies. Only these twins were reared in the same family, the same household, the same father. And their father was abusive, to put it mildly. He used to beat them. He used to beat their mother. He was awful. He was terrible. He was drunk. He was harsh. And that's how they grew up, with a father like that. Psychologists wanted to run experiments on monozygotic twins who were reared in the same household. So he went to visit one of them when he was in his mid-30s. That twin opens the door and brings the psychologist into his life. And the psychologist studies his life. And what he notices very quickly is that the twin is an alcoholic, that he abuses his children and his wife, that he is unemployed, losing jobs one after the other because of misbehavior, because of his drunkenness. And then he finds the twin in one sober moment to have a serious conversation with him and says to him, "Tell me, why are you doing this? How are you like this with your family, with your life? What are you doing?" To which the twin responded, "How do you expect me to be any other way when I had a father like this?" Now, the psychologist understands the impact of upbringing, of family, simply shrugs and moves on. He moves on and goes to the other twin, who also lets him into his house. And the other twin opens the door and he studies him. And what he finds with that other twin is that that twin is leading an amazing life, that he has a wonderful family, that he's an amazing father, that he's a great partner to his wife, that he loves his work passionately. In disbelief, he takes him to the side to talk to him, and he says, "How is it that you have this kind of life, that you're doing what you're doing?" And the twin looks at him and says, "How can you expect me to be any other way when I had a father like this? I didn't want to give my children, my family, what my father gave or didn't give us. I didn't want to ruin my life, so I changed it." Same genes, same environment, very different choices. And these choices can make all the difference, much more, in fact, than 40%. What this story captures is a very important truth within psychology, and that is that things do not necessarily happen for the best, but some people are able to make the best of things that happen. You see, many people believe that things happen for the best. I don't. And the data actually shows that they don't. I don't think either of the twins could say it was for the best that my father abused me or my mother. It didn't happen for the best. However, some, not all, but some people are able to make the best of things that happen by making different choices. There's a lot of research on that. For example, going to people with cancer and asking them to find the benefits, the good things that happened as a result of the cancer. Again, not telling them, and no one there thinks that the cancer happened for the best, but they can still find good things that came out of it. Things such as, well, we're closer to our family than we've ever been before. Or some people say, well, I just realize now how strong I am. I didn't know that, what I'm capable of. Or some people say, well, I really appreciate life a lot more now than I did before. It's not that it happened for the best, but some people are able to make the best of things that happen. And people who do that are not just happier, they're actually healthier. Their immune system is stronger, and they're more likely, it doesn't guarantee, far from it, but they're more likely to get better. The choices that we make a big difference. You see, the science of happiness does not lead us to lead happy lives all the time. That's not possible. There are only two kinds of people, in fact, who do not experience painful emotions. Emotions such as anger or sadness or anxiety or envy or disappointment. Two kinds of people who do not experience painful emotions. They are first the psychopaths, they do not experience these emotions. And second, dead people, they do not experience these emotions either. So you know, if you experience these painful emotions at times, it's actually a good sign. You're not a psychopath and you're alive. Good place to start. So the science of happiness does not make those painful emotions go away. What it does is simply strengthen our psychological immune system. What does it mean to have a strong psychological immune system? A strong psychological immune system doesn't mean we don't get sick. It just means we get sick less often, and when we do get sick, we'll recover more promptly. This is it. This is what the science of happiness can give us. This is how it can contribute to our life. Help us become more resilient and stronger. Now, you know, some people come to me and say, you know, I get this scientific empirical research, and it's actually quite good, I must admit, they say, but I'm worried. Why are you worried, I ask them, and they say, well, I'm worried because, you know, if I know this material very well, I'm not going to experience unhappiness and sadness, and I'm not going to fail, and how am I going to learn and grow, because we learn and grow from hardships and difficulties. I'm worried, they say to me, and I say to them, don't worry. Life will provide. Life always provides. Life is very good that way. It takes care of us. It brings us difficult experiences, whether it's in our relationships, whether it's with our kids, whether it's at work. Life always provides, so don't worry. Strengthen your immune system so that when you do get worried, when you do get sad, when things are hard, you're able to recover more promptly. And this is also the purpose of Happier TV. It's to help you make better choices, choices that are based on rigorous scientific research, choices that will contribute to your overall health, happiness, and well-being in good times as well as in difficult times. If it was all about our genes, then it would be futile to have Happier TV, just as it would have been futile to have Taller TV. But we know today from a lot of research, we know from personal experiences that it is possible to become happier. Our focus in Happier TV is on four zones. First of all, it's the self zone. It's personal happiness. It's about personal development. Then it's about parenting and relationships. How can we become happier in our interactions with others, whether it's at work, whether it's at home, with our children or with our partner? It's about the business and career zone, which is about professional development and organizational well-being. And finally, it's about health, the mind-body connection and their interaction. And within each one of these zones, what you will find are choices, big choices and small choices, but all choices that can change your life for the better, all choices that can help you thrive and flourish and fulfill your potential for the ultimate currency, the currency of happiness.